Hey guys, how are you doing? So this is Suraj, and from today onwards I am going to start a lecture series for English literature, especially UGC NET exam. And this is part 1 of Age of Chaucer. Now before I start, I would like to advise you, please go for the detailed study of social and political backgrounds of each and every period, because generally what we tend to do, we just go for writers and their works. But sometimes it happens that we get direct questions from the age itself. Okay. So talking about the general characteristics of the Age of Chaucer. Age of Chaucer is very renowned for, first of all, Age of Chaucer spans from 1340 to 1400. That is roughly the same as the own lifespan of Chaucer, who lived from 1343 to 1400. This age is very renowned for its rising spirit of nationalism, the social unrest prevalent over there, and the new religious movements, right? Three kings ruled over England during this time, and those were Edward III, Richard II, and Henry IV. Now, let's take the growth of nationalism. Actually, in 1328, England gets involved with France in Hundred Years' War that was started by Edward III, you know, because there was no heir in the French government during those times. So, Edward III claimed this position because of some maternal relations, and this conflict between England and France dates way back to 1066 AD when the Anglo-Norman War happens. You know, in Anglo-Norman War, the King of France, William, he attacked England and he conquered England. Okay, so after that, for 200 years, England is being ruled by French people. That is why we see that French language emerge as the most important language over there. After that, this age is also called Age of Transition, because you know, it's the link between the medieval times and the Renaissance period. In fact, Chaucer is considered as last of the medieval poets, and he is also called the morning star of Renaissance. This age is very chaotic and very happening. There are famines, there is this epidemic called the Black Death. Actually, there spread a plague in 1348 that wiped out 1/3 of the population of England. Now you can imagine how drastic it was. So there became scarcity of labor and human power. That is why we see the Peasants' Revolt coming in 1381. Actually, England was involved with France in wars. So there was heavy taxation also. So the peasants started to ask for a hike in their wages. That is why they revolted against the feudal system, and this revolt is also called Tyler Rebellion, because Wat Tyler was the leader of the Peasants' Revolt. Okay, remember this fact also. Now there is an act passed by Parliament in 1362 called the Statute of Pleading. You must know about this. Actually, through this act, English became the language of the Parliament and courts. Before that, we see that only French is the important language of courts and parliament, and only common people used to speak English. So English was not that important during those times. It was Chaucer who started the popularity of English language. This age, one more fact, is popular for critical attitude of public towards the church officials. Actually, what was happening in 1170s, you must have heard about Thomas à Becket. He got martyred in 1170s, and he was the Archbishop of Canterbury. That is why the church got so much popularity among the common people, that common people used to blindly follow them. So now the church started to misuse this belief, and we see that they are on the verge of corruption itself. Then came the social reformer John Wycliffe, and he started to question the church. In fact, some critics believe that it was the rising time of Protestantism, and John Wycliffe is considered as the one of the starting Protestants. Another major characteristic of this age is the alliterative revival. You know, in Anglo-Saxon times, poetry used to be written in the alliterative verses, but after that, for a certain period of time, we see it gets devoid of this. But in the age of Chaucer, alliterative verses are quite popular again. Now we will look at the main writers of the age. In fact, most of them are poets except for John Wycliffe and John Mandeville. So William Langland, John Gower and Geoffrey Chaucer, these are three major poets that you have to remember of this age. Now we will look at them one by one. William Langland is famous for his only work, Pious Ploughman. The full title is The Vision of William Concerning Pious the Ploughman. It is a dream allegory written in unrhymed alliterative verses. Actually, dream allegories were quite popular during those times, and in fact Chaucer also wrote quite a few of them. And in this, what used to happen, the poet would be lying in fields or in his bed, you know, and then he will suddenly fall asleep, and then he will get a whole story in the form of dreams. So this was the format. Now let's have a look at Pious Ploughman. Pious Ploughman is the story of Will. Will is the one who is lying in the field in summer season, and then he gets this dream vision about the whole story. So in this story, obviously it's an allegory, so you will see that abstract qualities of human nature will be depicted as characters. So he gets a lot of characters in this. So first of all, there appears Holy Church, who requests Will to seek truth, you know, to go on a pilgrimage to truth, and that is what the whole story is about. So Will goes on a journey to find truth, and in the way he finds all these characters. There is Lady Mead, who represents the temptation of riches. She is planning a marriage with False. Then some people bring her to the king, who proposes a marriage between Lady Mead and Conscience, but Conscience rejects her. Naturally, Conscience will reject immoral things and behavior, right? So the characters are representing their own traits. Then there is Reason, who, as the name suggests, he is giving a sermon to the field of folk. And after hearing this sermon, the seven deadly sins, who are the sinners, they repent, and now they also want to go to the pilgrimage to truth. But the problem is that no one knows how to achieve truth. So that is where Pious Ploughman enters the scene, and he is definitely the hero of the story. He is a wise, honest and hard-working guy who is ploughing his field, and he agrees to help them if they will plough his field with him, right? So after that, truth sends a pardon for the sinners, but a church priest object to this. So here William Langland is also criticizing the immoral behaviors of the church priest, and that is why it is also a social satire. Then there are many characters like Thought, who instruct them to do well, do better and do best. Basically, this is the whole gist of the story, to do well, do better and do best. Because this poem highly focuses on doing one's duty earnestly. If you can relate, like in Bhagavad Gita, Lord Krishna also stresses on the karma. So something sort of that, something like that. Then there are many characters like Fortune, Clergy, Patience, and one important character is Hawkin, who is wearing a coat of Christian faith soiled with seven deadly sins. Then at the end of poem, Will concludes that Pious Ploughman is Christ himself, and this is very important fact. At the end, Conscience goes on a pilgrimage to seek Pious Ploughman. So that is how the poem ends. And now let's look at another major literary figure, John Wycliffe. John Wycliffe was a reformer and scholar rather than a poet. Okay, he, in fact, his contribution to English literature is that he for the first time translated the whole Bible into English, because earlier English was Bible was only available in the Latin or Hebrew languages. So by Wycliffe, along with his followers, he translated Bible into English language, and his followers are now called Lollards, and this movement is called Lollard movement. If you remember, there was a question in NET December 18 exam about this also. In the starting, the term Lollard was used by the church priest to, you know, insult the followers of Wycliffe, but now it is accepted as that. And talking more about Wycliffe is known as Morning Star of Reformation. Who is known as Morning Star of Renaissance? Yeah, that's right, Chaucer. So Wycliffe was an Oxford educator, and he believed in the superiority of Bible. You know what, he was of the view that church officials are like middlemen. They were telling people what to do, what not to do, and people were blindly following them. So Wycliffe was of the view that everybody should possess a copy of Bible so that he knows what has been written in there, and he should only follow Bible. So this is quite revolutionary view of that time. And if you have a look at the works of Wycliffe, you will see that he was of the view that office of Pope is an occupation created by man and not by God. He is also condemning the Roman doctrines. He is calling for the vernacular translation of Bible. So church was quite against Wycliffe. And in 1415, we see that the Council of Constance declared Wycliffe a heretic and they banned his writing. Another writer of that time is John Mandeville. You know, John Mandeville was basically a traveler who used to write about his journeys. Nowadays, we see various travel bloggers writing about fascinating places. But during those times, it was only John Mandeville present there. Another major figure of that times is John Gower. John Gower was a friend to Chaucer, and he was also a court poet like Geoffrey Chaucer. Court poet means that they were writing for the people present in the court, right? The courtiers and other, the kings, noblemen, etc. So David Deitches made a remark about Gower that he was a more typical representative of his age and class than Chaucer could claim to be. Why did David Deitches said so? You know, Chaucer was writing only about the fallacies and absurdities of people. He was a humanist and he was describing only those things. But it was Gower who depicted the major problems and the situations that were going in those times. That is why David Deitches said so. Talking about the works of John Gower, there are only three important works by him, and those are Speculum Meditantis, Vox Clementis, and Confessio Amantis. Okay, he had written Speculum Meditantis in French language, Vox Clementis is written in Latin language, and his only English work is Confessio Amantis. So, Speculum Meditantis was initially named as Miroir del Homme, that is the French name, and it is about the seven deadly sins, you know, their offspring upon mankind, and it gives a review of corruption scenes in the world since Roman times to his present world, and it depicts the wickedness and the treachery of London merchants, shopkeepers, greedy friars and monks, etc. So you can say that he is writing about the social problems of that age. Another work is Vox Clementis. It is important to note here that it is about the peasants' uprising of 1381. Okay, always remember this fact. And the last important work by John Gower is Confessio Amantis. It was written when the king advised him to write something new. You know, Gower was always preaching in his writings, but in this work, he says that he will leave his genre of preaching and didactic purposes and he will start afresh. So it is composed of long short narrative poems, and it is 33,000 line poem written in octosyllabic couplets. It's a confession made by a lover to the priest of Venus. The most important literary figure of those times is undoubtedly Geoffrey Chaucer. That is why this age has been named after him. He was born in 1343, though this time is quite disputed among the critics, and Chaucer died in 1400. Now let's have a look at the life of Chaucer. Chaucer was born in Wintry, London. The name Chaucer literally means the shoemaker in the French language, but his father was a wine merchant. In his boyhood, he was appointed as a page to the Duke of Clarence, and later he also became a personal attendant to the king. He was very close to the king because when he got kidnapped by the French forces, the king ransomed him for £16. In 1366, Chaucer got married to Philippa Roet. Talking about the literary life, the critics have divided his life into three literary periods. The first of 30 years of his life, that includes his youth, was quite influenced with the French literary models, and that is why it is named as the French period. The second period of 15 years Chaucer had become a diplomat and now he was visiting various countries, you know. So when in 1372 he visited Italy, he must have met Petrarch and Boccaccio over there, and he got familiarized with their works. Petrarch and Boccaccio were the two pioneers of the revival of learning in Italy. Actually, the Renaissance started in Italy and it came in England in the 15th century only. Okay, so the third period is called English period, and this is the time when Chaucer wrote his masterpiece Canterbury Tales, and it is one of the most important works in the history of English language. Now let's discuss them one by one. So in the French period, Chaucer wrote two important works. Those were Book of Duchess and Romaunt of the Rose. Book of Duchess was an elegy written between 1369 and 1372 on the death of Blanche of Lancaster. She was the wife of John of Gaunt. John of Gaunt was the patron of Chaucer. You know, during those times, there were no publishers. So patrons were very important people who used to support writers. Romaunt of the Rose is just a translation of the French work Roman de la Rose. After that comes the Italian period, and first work is The House of Fame. House of Fame was an unfinished autobiographical poem in three books, and it is again a dream allegory written in octasyllabic couplets. So in this poem, the storyline is that Chaucer comments on the fickleness of fame. You know, the temporary nature of fame, the uncertainty about it, all has been represented very well by Chaucer. The story is that Chaucer falls asleep and he, in a dream, he is carried away by an eagle to the House of Fame. House of Fame is where the goddess of fame live. Goddess of Fame has been portrayed as having so many ears and eyes to listen to the rumors of the world. You know, she is a very moody person, and all the people come to her asking for anything, and she rewards or punishes them according to her will. The Parliament of Fowls is another work, and it was written to celebrate the marriage of King Richard II with Anne of Bohemia in 1382. Okay, this basically celebrates the theme of Valentine's Day and how one should have the choice to select their loved ones. It has been written in dream vision in Rhyme Royal. Rhyme Royal was a poetry form that was invented by Chaucer. Okay, it's basically a 7-line stanza with the rhyme scheme of ABABBCC. Chaucer invented this stanza, but it was called Rhyme Royal only after James I, the King of Scotland, he used it in writing a poem called The King's Squire. So after that, this poetry form is known as Rhyme Royal. So in Parliament of Fowls, it's another dream allegory. The narrator is reading Cicero's dream of Scipio when he is guided to a Venus temple. And from there on, he is guided to a hill of flowers where goddess nature is presiding over a conference of birds. You know, there we see a female eagle who has got three male suitors. But eventually the goddess nature gives the female eagle the freedom to choose or not to choose from among them. Troilus and Cressid is the longest finished poem of Chaucer. It contains 8,000 lines and has been divided into 5 books. The immediate source of the poem is Boccaccio's Il Flostrato, and it is again written in Rhyme Royal. Like Shakespeare, Chaucer also borrowed his plots and stories from other writers, but it was his flair of writing that made his works so interesting. So here also he transforms Boccaccio's story into a novel in verse. You know, many critics believe that he is the father of English poetry and he is the grandfather of English novel, because here also Chaucer has described the complications of Cressid's mind so well that one may think that it is a novel in verse. The story of it is a tale of Troilus' love for Cressida, his winning of her and her eventual desertion of him for the Greek Diomede. So you can say that it is a love triangle between the three. The story starts in Troy and has been set against the background of Trojan War. Those who don't know about the Trojan War, it was fought between the Greek and the city of Troy in ancient times, and the prince of Troy called Paris, he eloped with the queen of Greece. So the people of Greece got so angry that they waged a war against Troy. Okay. If you are a literature student, you must have come across the allusions and references of the Trojan War. For example, in Dr. Faustus, there is one when Dr. Faustus talks about the Helen of Troy. Now, coming back to the story of Troilus and Chryseid, they live in the city of Troy. Troilus is a soldier and Chryseid is a widow. Okay, one day when Troilus came across her in a place of worship, he falls for her, and Chryseid's uncle, his name is Pandarus, he helps Troilus in achieving her love. But the twist in the tales come when Chryseid's father, his name is Calchas, he decides to ditch his own country and join the Greeks. Chryseid in the beginning is very reluctant to do so, but she goes there with the promise that she will return in 10 days. But once she is in the Greek camps, now she realizes the futility of her promise, and she falls for a Greek soldier called Diomede there. Meanwhile, Troilus is making new stories day by day and excuses as to why Chryseid is not returning. He still believes that she will return one day, but there Chryseid and Diomede have fallen in love with each other. Now, one may think that Chaucer is representing this act by Chryseid and he is condemning this act, but when you go across the poem, you know, the way Chaucer has represented the complications of the inner mind of Chryseid, you will realize that Chaucer had a sympathy for Chryseid. He is not accusing her of anything bad, but still he was excused by the love god and the glorious women, and that is how he wrote the Legend of Good Women. Actually, they blame him for defaming the spirit of women, and that is why Chaucer repents and he starts to write glorious legend tales about the women from past, and 9 legends were written in this series. So we will do the English period of Chaucer in the next video. Till then, keep falling in love with literature. Thank you.